Hello, I'm AJ, and this medic to my heavy is...
Aaron.
And we are...
The Eclectiqueers.
Wasn't the future great?
Ever since our more innocent days, we've been treated to visions of the future that include floating cities, flying cars, teleportation, servile robots, etc. Yet very little of that has come to pass.
Hollywood is the maker of dreams. But they won't stick around to watch those dreams crumble. Oh no, they'll give you new ones to make up for the disappointment.
One of the more notable disappointments was delivered to us by the 1992 film
The Lawnmower Man.
Based very loosely on the Stephen King short story of the same name.
Oh! Don't you dare sully the name of Stephen King by associating him with this film.
You bitch!
The original name of the movie was Cyber God. He sued to have his name removed from the promotional material, but New Line disobeyed, and it was released to video unchanged. He was awarded $10,000 a day until they fixed it.
Well, that having been said, this was very much an exercise in style over substance. That it grossed triple its budget was an ominous sign of things to come.
The film opens with a text card bearing a spelling error and a very optimistic view of virtual reality's popularity.
Meanwhile, at VSI, who apparently hired the game developers behind Daedal and Opus to design their sign...
What fresh hell are you talking about?
Well, it's a Game Boy game from 1990. You know, you fill a space with pentominoes to move on to the next level. Maybe Jew Wario can clue you in.
Anyway, Remington Steele is arguing with his supervisor, Timms, about giving rage drugs to a chimp that is currently being used in an intelligence enhancement program.
I got it from the CIA!
Shut your damn pie hole, Dean!
This is coming from on high, the project being funded by a shadowy, implicitly evil group known only as The Shop. So what you're trying to tell me is that we've got a clandestine, shadowy, possible government, military... organization making an animal far more intelligent than it ought to be for the use in warfare for no adequately explained reason.
Mm-hmm.
Stephen King didn't want his name taken off of this because it had nothing to do with his story. Dean Koontz wanted the credit for this. Said chimp is then hooked into a war simulation in a gyroscope.
When he attempts to escape after this, he ends up killing some of the VSI workers before getting taken out himself. Don't kill him because he's a threat. Kill him because he's cosplaying as Judge Dredd.
Whoa, wait a minute here. Mm-hmm. So we have an inarticulate primate with a belligerent attitude that perceives everything as a threat, and it starts killing innocent people.
Yeah, and he's looking for weapons and access into places that he really doesn't have a right to get into.
No, don't be obvious.
I think we're getting the hang of this whole gamer score thing. So, was the whole intro to this movie a dream?
If anything, that shot was loud enough to wake Dr. Larry out of his sleep. Divisions of war on every station.
With all the jump cuts, it's hard to tell if he was changing the channel or if the program was poorly edited.
After getting kicked out of bed for smoking and witnessing a brief instance of spousal and child abuse... VSI calls him up to let him know his monkey is taking a dirt nap now.
That morning, Larry serves up a delicious plate of ham.
He just ran the program we embedded.
There you go.
Like 5 years of research down the drain.
We'll get you another chimp.
That chimp was the key to my moving onto a human subject.
Oh man, the war machine wants me to make weapons. I didn't sign on for this. I'm a pacifist. Blah.
Look. Why don't you take a hiatus and we'll restructure around here?
You know, with all he's done, he's probably earned a nice long vacation somewhere. But first, we need more characters. This Irish pickle is Terry McKean. He runs a landscaping business with what might as well be his adopted son, Job.
Job is a bit slow and often punished by Terry's brother, a priest. You really do get the sense that he's troubled beyond his mental handicap.
Despite this, Job is able to repair a motorized lawnmower, so maybe he's a mechanical savant.
After being hassled by a Ben Affleck wannabe at the gas station, presumably for dressing like Chucky, Timms speaks with a big giant head of the shop, indicating that they can't proceed without Larry.
Dear the shop, rule one, never head a project with someone who is irreplaceable or has a moral compass that points in completely the opposite direction from your intended goal. Again, isn't this Dean Koontz's The Lawnmower Man?
We find Larry is vacationing in virtual reality, swimming in a kaleidoscope puddle surrounded by blacklight fish gravel.
For 1992, this is really quite impressive, but we're nearly 15 minutes in, and the only serious plot-moving point is the death of a chimp. Now, before we go any further, I need to make one thing perfectly clear. There is an unrated director's cut of The Lawnmower Man that actually adds an additional 40 minutes of film. To my knowledge, we looked for this. There isn't a DVD release of the unrated director's cut. Now, with those additional 40 minutes, complete changes to the story take place. Characters die that don't die in the story. Characters don't die that do die in the theatrical release. An entirely new way of being introduced to characters occurs. And honestly, it's a much better flow of the story. It tells the story a lot better. And honestly, I would highly recommend it.
Falling, floating, and flying? So what's next, fucking?
Really? Well, that's one hell of a logic jump.
We're very glad we're not attracted to women after that.
Uh-huh.
Well, Caroline proves to be an understandably angry shrew, since he's more interested in his work than her. I don't know how long they've been married, but she doesn't even seem to like him.
This is not a good time for me right now.
Sadly, this was very true. The year before this was released, Pierce's first wife, Charlotte, died of cancer, and acting was his way of working through the grief. He met his second wife while he was filming Goldeneye.
While our hearts go out to the man for his loss, he clearly was not at his best for this role, or for those roles that followed after this film.
For most of his performance, he either hams it up or phones it in, but this scene with Caroline, it really does sound like it's coming from a place of genuine grief and pain.
I don't feel like being around people right now. I don't feel like going to the city.
You never want to go anywhere, Caroline.
This scene is followed by Carolyn having a "It's the science or me" hissy fit, which is tempered by Job mowing the lawn and interacting with Peter Parquette, the neighbor.
Now, if you've read the short story, you'll recognize that surname as that of the victim who wanted his grass cut.
That is the only meaningful connection to the original story. A last fucking name. So, did he not see that? How many helpless pedestrians did he mow down on his way home? No pun intended.
Back at the church, Father McKean lays into Job for not earning his keep.
Working from Psalm 51, verse 5, he must feel justified in beating Job as he does, for he was born a sinner and is unable to move beyond it because he's too stupid to learn from his mistakes.
That, or he's a vindictive gluteal milliner.
You have no idea of what I'm going through, do you?
My work is falling apart, and you decide to leave me.
It's dead for both of us.
Here's a man, clearly distraught, being open about his emotions with you, and you nag at him about his drinking and say your marriage is dead? Fuck you, lady!
Again, this is why we're glad we have no attraction to women. Well, except for Nala.
And Lindsay.
Lupa.
Jezu Otaku.
Diamond Hagan.
And last but not least...
Oh, for the love of penis!
9 days out of work and post-wifely abandonment... Larry's at the edge of his rope. He laments about not having a test subject until he notices Job mowing the lawn.
Ooh, looks like we've switched to an episode of Reboot.
No, sadly, this is still Lawnmower Man.
Well, if you were smarter, I mean, people wouldn't be able to take advantage of you.
Slash begins now!
Will you stop that?
I can make you smarter. But only if you want, and you must never tell anyone.
The way that Dr. Angelo talks about making Job smarter, it sounds like a win-win. But seeing what it did to the chimp makes it a bit hard to swallow that this is all for Job's benefit.
Well, given what happens next, I think it's fair to say that he's trying to cause a seizure.
Ah! It's gonna hit me!
No, it's not gonna hit.
By the way, this is Marnie. She exists. She kind of has a role later on, honestly, but she's not essential to the plot.
Following the equivalent of a training montage, we're back to playing games with Peter. It's when Father McBeady barges in on Job looking at himself shirtless that we notice a change in his behavior.
Notice how Job's speech patterns have changed, if ever subtly.
You know you shouldn't hit people.
Jeez, the look in his eyes just screams you can't boss me around anymore. Fahey can emote, even within the limited range of his character's capabilities, more so than the rest of the cast.
Well, I'm looking forward to having my lawn mowed soon.
Was that innuendo?
Why are you asking me? I don't speak hetero.
Dr. Angelo, I think people can tell that I'm changing.
Into David Cassidy?
Rawr.
Why is there a Pokeball in that box?
This is some of the most advanced computer equipment in the world.
By the looks of the room and its lighting, it will be all replaced for Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Why the hell is Larry also in the gyroscope? Couldn't he and shouldn't he monitor or control this externally?
Change brainwave parameters. Initiate second level.
Well, if you insist.
Lord Jesus, Mother of God, would you look at that?
I'm sleeping and right in the middle of a good dream. Like all at once I wake up from something that keeps knocking at my brain. Before I go insane, I hold my pillow to my head and spring up in my bed, screaming out the words I dread. I think I love you. I think I love you.
She gets squishy for him and they bump uglies.
Moving on.